Let's talk about number 2's. Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. If you're listening to the podcast on Spotify, I very much appreciate it. And if you're over on Patreon, love it. Thank you so much. So in today's video, we're going to have a lot of things to reference. But before we jump into it, check it out. I have a little bit of a sort of tea brewed. When I was on my road trip, as many of you guys know, I traveled around the US twice, solo road trips, both 10,000 miles. But the second trip, I really learned how to brew my own thing. So I grew basically basil, mint, cilantro, herbs, tomatoes, like a whole bunch of stuff in the back of my car, peppers, while I was on the road. And I learned that I love the combination of basil and mint dried out and then brewed into a tea. So that's what I have to my left currently. So good. No sweetener needed. Just really refreshing, really clear. Now, okay, in today's video, I'm going to reference a lot about the levels. We're going to deep dive into the idea of why you should be a 2 and why it's good to be in 2 and why enlightenment is not for everyone. The idea and concept of enlightenment has been branded for 2's and sort of journeyed by the 5's. The 5's in my observational philosophy, the levels, are the enlightened humans. Humans who, again, just in terms of their ability to observe their own existence, have an ability to truly examine. And the reason I say and want to specify that it's not a matter, when I say high functioning, low functioning, of a person's mental ability or capacity or educational background, is because it doesn't matter. In terms of enlightenment, any person in the world who has a functioning brain and, you know, in a capacity that can problem solve, has an ability to have or seek the path of enlightenment, right? There's a lot of woo-woo talk around enlightenment that I don't subscribe to, but I think can help us push the conversation forward as well. Terms like magic or woo-woo or energy or feeling might seem foreign, and to be honest, sometimes it makes my brain hurt. So Kyoti, my friend, wrote to me the other day after my last podcast, and he was like, yo, note about why it's good to be a 2. You say, but rarely get into detail. It's true, I do. The 2 bubbles protect them from doubt. Quote, am I doing the right thing? Can I count on these people, etc. The 4 5's, okay, people who have crossed that bridge of the 3, the 4 5's know that people could do anything. For the 4, that's terrifying. And for the 5, it's key to an exciting and dynamic life. But for both, it is a stress thought that isn't there for the 2's. I think it's important to explain what 2's are getting out of being 2's, what's attractive, healthy, stable about it. For example, Maud and Harold and Maud, great film, highly recommend. Get ready for a emotional roller coaster. For example, Maud is the older woman in the story, is a 5, and does a crap load of things that are quite traumatic for Harold to push him out of his 4 nihilism. But doing those same things to a 2 would be cruel. 2's can often pretend to be nihilists, or rather live a 2 nihilistic version of the world. You'll see them on YouTube. They're the people who think like, fuck it, nothing matters, we're just monkeys, we're just fucking animals. It's like, okay, negative Nancy's, right? When I say things, I'm like, we're just animals, a part of the planet. It's fucking beautiful, dude. You're like, have so much power in the world. Completely different ways of seeing the world, right? Could both be viewed as nihilism to an extent. But of course, I think all things matter versus like a nihilist thinks nothing matters. Also, positive nihilists, you'll see them on the internet as well. And I have a whole video about this, but positive nihilists on the internet, again, 2's in denial of their own reality, wanting to claim they're the most real people and try to find a positive spin on reality. You don't need to positively spin reality. It is amazing. Like, you don't have to trick yourself into thinking it's good. It's pretty cool. Give or take a couple of details. Okay, so in the movie, you know, Maud pushes Harold basically out of his 4 stage of nihilism, but it would be cruel to do that to a 2. And it says 5's aren't stable. They're healthy, alive, vibrant, but they're not stable. This is key. This is hard to explain to people. 2's seek out stability. We seek out consistency. And I understand that because when I was traveling through the world of the 2's, it very much felt like I was trying to find my place, my inner circle, my guilds, my real clear, concise observation of society. I tried to be an objectivist. I was very Randian at like a hot second in my life. And then I jumped into like just being a conservative and seeking out like the comfortability of what I was raised in, and going into leftist circles and seeking the radical nature of their belief systems. I tried to find my identity through the world. That is so a number 2 thing to do versus like a 5. It comes from the inside out. It doesn't come from the outside in, but they use the world to reflect on their ideas, right? So I can observe the world through books. I can observe it through what we're drinking. I can observe it through fashion. I can observe it through how we grow life in our, you know, in our world. But as a two, I could only see it through the lens of what's been established for me. As I traveled, like, from the two world into the five, I realized I could start really identifying things for either what they literally were or what they could be in a much more vibrant and exciting way, but it doesn't exactly breed stability. But we'll get into that into a hot second. To set this up, I want to pull from Confucius. This is Confucius Speaks. I found this book actually through a Goodwill website, and it cost a butt ton, so I'm so sorry in advance for people who might not be able to get it. Like, the original price is relatively cheap, but getting it shipped from where I got it shipped from took a lot of dough, so, you know, don't feel pressured to grab it. Check out your local libraries, of course. But to start us off, check out these two little comics. So if you guys don't know, they're like little, they look like little comics. They're super cute. The first one on the left says knowledge and study. I wasn't born with the knowledge I have. I just like to study the ancient books, and I pursue their ideas with a keen mind. The second one, learning from others. If there are three people walking along, there's certainly one I can learn from. I notice their strong points and work to emulate them. I notice their defects and try to change if I find them in myself as well. This is the key right here. I always say it, and I'll say it again. I really think my journey out of mania, my journey out of mental illness, my journey out of so much, and I'm not saying that I'm cured. I'm not making that claim. I'm making the claim that I'm better, stable, and haven't had episodes in almost 2 years. Okay, this October will be my 2-year anniversary. And books and knowledge were key. Having 2,000 plus books of knowledge in my head, regardless if I can reference all of them or even remember all the books I read, doesn't even matter. Because at this point, I've spent literally 15 plus years just consuming. Well, what do you do when you have all that information? How do you actually put it into practice? Well, you start problem solving. You read it with a keen mind, an open and interesting, you know, introspective mind, and then you build on top of it. You notice that in the comic, he says, if there are three people walking along, there's certainly one I can learn from. It's this, not only this hope and this positive expectation of culture and society, but of the human condition, to know that a person walking is definitely not just walking. You know what I mean. You're seeing a person who can really show you something you don't know. You have to really believe that about humans to truly be a good student. I personally went through a phase in my two world where I stopped believing humans could teach me something. And that was terribly arrogant of me. And that happened when I was on the left. And there's a reason for that. Because I went from conservative to leftist, I thought I was progressing forward, but I was just changing identities, but I was reflecting what I saw from the world. An assumption that people were out to get me, an assumption that America was a hard place to exist, but a good place, because I think all leftists and all conservatives truly believe that, or they would all leave, right? So as much as Republicans complain about big government, they love it. As much as leftists complain about the patriarchy or whatever, they love it, or they would leave. There are other countries you can exist in. I come from an immigrant background. I know you can pick up and move, okay? And then, of course, the other side of that coin was just seeing everyone through the lens of my own rules of reality. Now, some people have been critical of my work, saying you've pulled this philosophy out of your ass. All philosophy comes from ass. And if we don't acknowledge that, then we're not acknowledging, once again, that all humans can teach us something. I love reading about Rand, but I also disagree with Rand and think she's a two. I think she's like most people who've come to a very bitter conclusion about existence, claiming to have the joy that I never really saw through her work or her followers' work. Most of the Randians I meet are not joyful people, but they are very, for the most part, attempting to be very objectivist. My philosophy isn't here to teach you morals or ethics. It's not about that. It's just an ability for you to process how much you're really acknowledging and processing other people and your own existence. And that's the conundrum, right? So here we go. We're going to close this book and put it down here. Okay. The next book I want to read or show you is The Trouble with Normal Sex Politics and the Ethics of Queer Life. I'm reading it by Michael Warner, and I'm reading this book, once again, shipped out from a Goodwill, because I can't find these things anywhere else, apparently. And the thing that was interesting about this book is not only the typos and the horrible writing, no offense. He is Michael Warner, PhD, is a professor of English at Reuters. Is that how you say that name? University of Reuters? University, where he teaches American literature and queer studies. And he's an author of many other books. Actually, the reason I'm reading it is because the James Franco book I did for research, he referenced this book as one of his favorites because this man taught him, apparently, or he knew him through school. And the back of the book has, like, Judith Butler praising it. And, like, Judith Butler is a fierce queer feminist and philosopher. And I was like, oh, okay, shit. And, you know, all these other people, Professor of Law Columbia, Kendall Thomas. And it's just like, I'm reading this, right? But I'm reading this book, and it is, and I mean this with the most, like, compassionate energy, meaning to suffer with. Like, I get it. I've been here. I've written awful books, too. But it's a little basic. But let me tell you something. If I was in the world of the two still, and I was still struggling with my homosexuality, my queerness, my gayness, and I walked into Barnes & Noble, and I used to go to the queer section, and I would grab books, I think this book would feel enlightened to me. In one of the passages, he talks about, you know, orgies and queer sex and being not normal, embracing that kind of dirty, seedy side of, like, the queer experience, the sort of, like, hyper even, like, sexuality of it, give or take, which is a stereotype of heterosexual communities trying to undermine gay rights and activism. But at the same time, again, world of the two problems, okay? At the same time, like, having sex is not revolutionary. You know, Zizek says, he talks about being trans and how it's really not that revolutionary.
Marx was much more right. He should have also added in Communist Manifesto not only social forms, but even what we perceive as natural forms. Life on Earth, our gender sexual identities are much more fluid, unnatural, and so on and so on. So this, I think, compels us to think more radically, to question many presuppositions. Ah, another nasty thing I want to provoke you politically. Marx mentions in Communist Manifesto also that all old patriarchal relations are, with developed capitalism, are undermined, rendered fluid, and so on and so on. And that's why I think, with all my respect for transgender movement and so on, that's why I am not surprised that transgender movement is so immensely popular among great corporate figures of the United States. You remember when month before Trump was elected, I mean, this is, I think, one of the reasons why he won, the main topic of big left liberal media like New York Times and so on, what to do with transgender toilets? Is it two, three, is it single toilet, and so on and so on? And what made me a little bit suspicious is that all of them, Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, name them, all of them fanatically, even the worst capitalist, like who is now, I forgot, after Steve Jobs, the boss of Apple, Tim Cook or who, they all fully supported it. I mean, we should accept it, yes, of course, but that's another topic. Transgender, me too. But they are not, I claim, inherently revolutionary. They fit perfectly the dynamic of late capitalist subjectivity with this infinite plasticity and so on and so on.
You're a two, you're in a bubble, and all you know is that bubble. And you think the only thing that matters is your bubble. You think that being gay is the most important part of your life because it is. Because you've created a life and are surrounded by people who reinforce the idea that this is the most important thing about you. And the truth is that it's not. Midnight Sun, the Twilight books. Do you remember the time when, well, I was reading it in high school, I was 15, it came out in the 2000s. And I graduated high school in 2006 for a reference, for no, 2007. So for those of you who need to reference timing, I was reading this book in high school and people would make fun of me. Ugh, this book is so long. Why are you reading it? It's about vampires. Lame. And me being the nerd emo kid I was just didn't care, right? I'm like a theater kid. I don't care. Then all of a sudden next year, everyone and their mom is reading it. And I was like, well, okay, why do people go from bullying people to enjoying the thing they bullied them about? And then why in turn years later did the younger groups of girls start attacking Stephenie Meyer for being Mormon and conservative and start calling the book a pedo book? This is the conundrum of the 2's. Let me explain. So in the world of the 2's, right, Stephenie Meyer went from being an amazing author who wrote a great little, you know, young adult series that we all fell in love with, all went to the movies, all loved, right? But then after the third wave feminist and young people got a hold of Twitter and Tumblr, mostly Tumblr, they started to become critical of Stephenie Meyer's work. This 100-year-old vampire is basically a pedophile attracted to a 14-year-old girl. What is happening? Or 16-year-old girl or whatever she was in the book. But either way, oh my gosh, this is awful. What is happening? Well, what's happening, children, is that a vampire, not a real thing, okay, we use them in fiction to explore our own mortality. So the other day when my brother asked me as I was barbecuing outside the house, hey, what book are you reading? I'm like, oh, I'm reading a book about a man who doesn't die, who's over 100 years old, who's contemplating his own existence as a possible monster while falling in love with a high school girl, and he sparkles in the sunlight. And he's like, are you reading Twilight? I was like, yes. But the truth is that fiction allows us to explore. Fiction allows us an opportunity to be different. So why in the world of the 2's do people go from loving to hating to now loving again? But this is the problem with the world of the 2's. They think that they're enlightened because they read some Tumblr post or a book on feminism once. But what they don't realize is that the people who write these books are also human and flawed. And so just because things sound good doesn't mean it is. They all did. Really jumped on this bandwagon that Stephenie Meyer was really setting women back. Writing this book about Bella, who's sort of agreeable but not agreeable, sort of annoying but not annoying, quiet, passive but not. Like, it's weird. As I'm reading Midnight Sun and I'm reading it from Edward's perspective, Bella's a badass. Like, she's kind of a badass. Like, she literally is attempting to make her boundaries clear. She's attempting to be strong towards Edward. Now, of course, this book is written 15 years later, so maybe the perception of Edward, i.e. Stephenie Meyer, has changed enough to allow the character to be written differently. But again, in the world of the 2's, they centered their whole universe on a book series. Like, they got into it. Just like with Harry Potter. Like, Harry Potter, our J.K. Rowling situation, talk about the world of the 2's, right? Their whole life, okay, or at least a large portion, even 10% of their day, to be spent on this obsession with Harry Potter, obsession with J.K. Rowling and her opinions, obsession with this world. These are all number 2 bubbles, right? Imagine you're born in a different place. Let's say you're born in Iraq, where my parents were born, at a time when you weren't really reading American books. You were more living an Iraqi existence, right? So their bubble gives them the information that they have, which is that the world is a war zone, or the world is beautiful, or the world is an oasis surrounded by chaos. Like, my mother grew up in the country, while my father grew up in the city. So they had 2 different experiences. My father, who recognizes through the lens of the Catholic Church that God gave them this existence and it's beautiful, and his family, they're engineers, and so they have, his mom's a professional seamstress in Iraq. You know, this is my dad as a child, I'm imagining. So he imagines that his life, driving at 12 years old from Baghdad to El Kush to pick up people, his life is so different in comparison to, like, my mother's, who grew up in a home that, you know, lives in a village, and there's no electricity and no toilet. There's just a hole in the ground and you go and do your business. That her brothers died as infants, as children, days later because they got a package from America where there was mothballs and it killed the children, right? Like, she's thinking in her head that these experiences tell her that the world is like this. And I wonder if there's more out there. Like, this is just what she knows. These are just normal occurrences. My father was just telling me the other day about how his sister died when they were kids. And he goes, yeah, you know, you have another aunt. And I was like, I do? And he goes, well, she died. You know, a lot of people don't count her as existing because she was only alive for, like, a very short time. And I was like, oh, that's awful to me. Because in my head, like, all, like, you were alive. You were a breathing person. I mean, in Chaldean culture, in Middle Eastern culture, I mean, you start counting the days of your baby's life when they are conceived, basically, when you know you're pregnant. So when I was born, I wasn't a day old. I was 9 months and I was living my first day outside the womb. You know, we think of life as very sacred. Now, what happens, though, when my immigrant parents come to America and now they're in a different bubble? And they're experiencing it all the same through the 2's, but a different 2's bubble. Well, they find that America is great, that it has advancements, that there's running water and electricity and amazing things and fast cars, and they can be engineers to a different degree. My mom can be a stay-at-home mom. We can live in a nice neighborhood. My parents can move their kids. We had, you know, they had 10 kids in America. They could feed them and clothe them. And yeah, we got hand-me-downs all my life. And yeah, we like, you know, we eat a lot of Chaldean food, which is not only healthier for you, but it's also cheaper compared to American frozen food and all these things. So I was growing up with different smells and tastes and languages, but they felt, because they had come from one place to another, that they had ascended in a large way, ascended into something different. Okay. So then I start to think about their life in that way. Like, that must have been very amazing for them. My mother, who came to America and said being a stay-at-home mom is something honorable, her whole life not understanding why she's not getting along with a lot of women in America, only to misunderstand that stay-at-home moms in America are more or less agreeable women. That's why they're so angry, you know, and that's why they all got divorced, and that's why the divorce rate went up, because they realized they didn't have any control in their lives. Rather than in Iraq, though they had arranged marriages, my mother was the first woman to ever divorce a man after, you know, arranged marriage in her family, and she got ostracized for that, had a love marriage with my dad. My mom still, even though it all sounds similar, was not like these women. My mom came to America being unagreeable. Like, my mother is unagreeable, like I am unagreeable. Like, we are not agreeable women, right? So when my mom came here and she said, Betsy, you should be a stay-at-home mom so you can sit here and raise your children and let your husband go to work, she wasn't saying, because you're a woman who should be second class and be held at home doing nothing, and because you are a woman and this is what a man does, a man works. No, she said, you stay at home and you run that household. You have those kids. I mean, she homeschooled, like, 10 of us at the same time, literally took us to all these like practices and social events and all these things. My one mother, well, my father went to work and provided for those mouths to feed. We never starved as kids. Even if my parents took the hit for us, we didn't know. Like, if we were running low on money, my parents never made it clear to us that we wouldn't be fed first. And it's not, you know what I'm saying? Like, they have a real sense of duty to their children, regardless of when I got older and I started to come out as queer, they had to deal with that bubble being popped. So here are my parents, again, these number 2's existing in a world being popped again. Here's another one. Your kid's gay. What do you do now? What do you do now with your religion? It's like every time they're faced with a new challenge, every time they think, oh, we have a nice house and healthy kids, we have the American dream, one of their kids turns around and goes, I'm an addict. I had sex outside marriage. I have this problem. I have this problem. I have this problem. And they sit there and they think to themselves, okay, this is very different than in Iraq, where in that bubble, you didn't do these things. The only people they knew who were gay in Iraq were molesters, like literally pedophiles. They had no sense of reference, no point of reference for a homosexual who didn't molest children. So when they came to this country and they heard that I was queer, they were like, oh no, like, what does this mean? You know, when they found out my brother was gay, what does this mean? You know, they really had a moment of panic, guys. I just want you to process what that must have been like. All the while, all of the discoveries are being made in the world of the 2's, right? These are all still 2 problems. This has nothing to do with enlightenment. This has everything to do with just existing and living life. And that's why it is so hard to understand what it means to be a 2, because a 2 has levels. You can be a 2C, a person who's barely functioning but still functional. 2Bs that are my parents, you know, they figured out their life. They figured out how to have the things they want, to raise kids they love, to bond with their family, to make things work for them. And they know something's going on in the world, but they don't exactly know the details or how to fix it. So they still vote Republican and conservative and Trump because it fits their narrative of their bubble. I, on the other hand, went another way. In my 20s, I went to the left and I said, no, I'm going to vote Democrat. I'm leaving the Republican Party. I'm a registered independent. I'm going to start voting with my conscience, my values. You know, I can't vote for Trump. It's 2016. I'm in turmoil. There's no way. I feel incredibly smart. I think I'm enlightened to an extent. Like, I'm literally sitting here as a 2-3 on this bridge of just struggle. Here I am, this person who's like, yes, this must be the answer. Systematic racism, homophobia, transphobia, like this is the answer. We need to stop people's, you know, misunderstanding of others to better the world. But then I looked at the world after Trump won and I saw the way that I went crazy, I saw the way my friends went crazy, and I was like, this can't be good, because if we're the ones who know more, then shouldn't we feel more powerful because we have the wisdom to know more? But no, we didn't have wisdom. We were all struggling in this world of the chaotic twos, trying to figure out what to do, Hillary or Trump, Hillary or Trump, Hillary or Trump, right? Within those moments from 2016 to this date now, was quite a journey for me in terms of understanding myself. I had to literally abandon, let go of the chaos of that world. And it actually was because of a BLM activist who had lunch with me one day. She's so dope. And we sat down and I was heading to a conference, still in the world of the twos, floating in the bridge of the three, you know. And the three bridge, for those of you who don't know the observational philosophy, means that you can observe that your life needs to go in a different direction, but as you look back at what you've built, you're almost afraid to let it go, because as you're on the bridge to enlightenment, you're still it's like when Aang in Avatar the Last Airbender is like trying to save the world, but his chakra is blocked because he can't let go of Katara. You have to let go of the world in order to save the world. You have to. And people can't. And it's not even that you don't want to. It's just that the road to enlightenment is a very isolated one. There is a time in your life when you really do have to isolate. And I think you have to experience something extreme and traumatic, and you might not survive it. There are many reasons to stay a two. They can live in a bubble and be reassured by that bubble. When Quixote says that the life of a two is stable, what he's saying is, and when he says the life of a two has no doubt, when you're in the world of twos, let's say you're super hyper religious, you can always take comfort and solace in the word of God. My sister-in-law recently sent me this really adorable series for Catholics on existence, happiness, and joy. And she's like, please watch it. This reminds me of your levels. Because, you know, I share my levels with everybody. And I watched the first episode. I'm going to watch the second one today so I can talk to her about it tomorrow. And I told her, you know, the conundrum with religion is that in order to have the objective answer of truth, you have to first have a belief in a God. So I said to her, you know, the problem with religion is that in order to find this truth that this video claims to be offering me, you first have to have a belief in God. And what I'm saying is that my philosophy system isn't offering you like objective truth, the answers to the universe. It's offering you a tool to know where you are on your journey to being introspective and whether or not you need to head to enlightenment to have a joyful or happy life. Okay? So in the world of the twos, if you're not a religious person, let's say you're black. Let's go there, people. A lot of you are black in my audience. I feel you. I see you. Check it out, okay? A black woman comes to me, sits me down for a lunch, and says to me, as I'm heading into this conference for work, she goes, why are you doing this? And I go, I feel like I should be here for my career. And she goes, why? She goes, these people are never going to see you. And I said, what do you mean? She goes, they don't really get you, right? And I was like, no. She goes, why are you appealing to them? And I said, I don't know. Someone keeps telling me that, like, and by someone, I mean, like, the world, right? Keeps telling me that the number two world, that for my career, I'm supposed to go to these conferences and shake hands. And these are the people who are supposed to put me where I need to go. And she goes, I don't really know if that's the answer. We had another conversation a little bit more in depth. But overall, she looked at me and said, you don't have to choose this bubble. Now, I think this woman is very interesting. And who knows if she's a two or a three, I don't know. Sometimes I think she's just a really enlightened two. But that's interesting all the same, because she had this great piece of wisdom to give me. And then I realized everyone has something to teach me. Everyone. And what that woman that day did is change the trajectory of my life. I was under super amounts of stress. I was going through a lot of issues with like just like a stalker and a whole thing. It was a mess. And I took that moment to choose myself and my family. And it was the right decision. It was a very good decision. And that changed my whole life, right? I stopped living in a bubble that I had chosen and once again left it. In all of my life, one of the things I hear from people consistently is like, Brittany, you change all the time. You change all the time. And it's true. Gosh, I've gone through so many versions of myself in search of this one that I am now. This like final form, as I call it. Like if this was Dragon Ball Z, this would be my final, my perfect cell form, my final, you know, this is it, baby. It's meant to convey to the world that I'm not going to tomorrow, you know, become homeless, or I'm not tomorrow going to do anything out of a choice that would land me in a position where I'm all of a sudden gambling at casinos, or I'm a drag queen on stage, or any of these things, because my life now is very much exactly what I want it to be, and this is what I have chosen. So I know at the root of who I am, with all the, you know, opportunities I've had, this is the life I've chosen for myself. But sometimes when we're in the world of the 2's, we wake up and realize, I don't know that I chose this for myself. And that's what makes us feel very in conflict with our identities. My whole life, I was in search of choosing my life, like the power to choose my life. And when I found it, it didn't look the way that I thought it was going to look. It looks very chaotic. What do I always tell you guys? You have to find peace in the chaos. So in the world of the 2's, I had no doubt. I felt so arrogantly, this is the answer. This is the answer. And now I'm like, the answer is not that arrogant. The answer isn't that angry. The answer isn't anything more than this is life. That we are part of an ecosystem living in an existence that is shared and therefore naturally chaotic. Instead of trying to change or make the chaos stop, I embrace the chaos and live in it. So I believe every person can surprise you and change. I think some people remain stagnant, and that's why I have a category called the 1's, which are people who basically have every opportunity to change, every reason to change, but don't. They somehow fail at it in almost a poetic way, right? And observing Trisha Paytas in my last podcast, I'm on this debate of whether or not she's a 2 or a 1. And after the last few posts she's put out, she's going down the path of a 1. So if she isn't a different person within the next 6 months in a way that is so significant, in the way that it was significant for me, I mean, how many of you people have seen me? And I, again, will show you clips in the future of past Brittany versus this Brittany. The change is so clear and peaceful, and obviously, like, I'm happy as fuck in a way that I've never been, in a way that I used to almost like, oh my God, this must be happiness, dude. Even though I'm stressed and having borderline episodes, this must be happiness. Nah, dude. I'm talking about no borderline, no anxiety, no PTSD in any mental way. A normal people way, sure, but in no mental illness kind of way am I drowning in my own brain. I'm actually floating and loving life, right? Every day I wake up and I'm like, sweet, dude. Life is great, dude. I love life, you know? I've never done that before. I've never woken up and just loved my life every day. And I've been doing that for almost 2 years. And I don't know what to do with that except ride this wave all the way to fucking, I don't know, heaven. Whatever future is in store for me, right? But when you're in the world of the 2's, the conflict within you is so consistent. It's like you wake up every day and the first thing you think is, you know, I have to do something or be something or look a certain way. I've been watching a lot of Queer Eye with Marcus, my brother. And one of the things that we love about it, and he asked me, he's like, what are these guys on a level scale? I'm like, oh, they're all 2's and they're helping the fuck out of these people. Like, there was a man, this beautiful, wonderful man that he went to. I think his name was Kenny. He was Catholic, shout out. And he lived in stagnation. His parents' house was exactly the same as it was when he was a kid. 1970s furniture. The things were dusted. Everything was consistent. He didn't have to, you know, really change. Or maybe he didn't even know how to change, which is interesting. He has his family and friends all around him, but no one could really get to him in the same way until these 5 gay guys. Okay, I need you to process this for me. Kenny's in his 60s, living in stagnation. Very nice. Everyone has everything good to say about him. Never looks inward, always helps everyone but himself. Very nice person. He lived in a time when gay marriage was illegal, when homosexuals were being killed, growing up in a time that was very hostile towards gays. And he had to grow up in a universe where, like, he had to, while he was doing this, gay people were fighting for their rights. And then eventually Queer Eye and Kenny met up in the same universal bubble. You know what I'm saying? Like, do you know how many things had to happen, like, naturally, the natural progression of the world for Kenny to meet the Queer Eye guys? So here are 5 homosexuals. Fabulous, wonderful, different, coming to this conservative place, meeting this conservative man, taking him into their arms and redoing his life for him in a way that shows him in a way he can understand how he can be a different person. Kenny went from sweet sportsman / pedo mustache to I drink red wine and I definitely take showers. And I love it. Like, this man transformed his life. He was so grateful, so different looking. Guys, I mean, I'm not even exaggerating to you how even changing a hairstyle can completely change your trope. You know how I always say anime people are, you know, we're all in an anime, we're all in a trope, we're all in a fictional book, we're all a trope. Kenny was a trope, and no one in his life could help him. And it took history going the way it was to the point where gay rights had to happen so 5 gay guys could get a TV show and their parents, his family, whoever, could reach out to the gay guys to come help the straight man. Like, do you... This is amazing. This is beautiful. Me, right now, here I am. I had to have the life I did on the internet and my whole life to get to the point where I had this conversation with this black woman who I never would have met otherwise because she was in the, like, just, like, even though we had technically, guys, I'm not even, you want to talk, check this out. That same woman was in a BLM chapter in Seattle the same time I was in Seattle. We should have met up. We should have crossed paths. We should have met each other many times. When she asked me, like, oh, what queer circles or POC circles do you hang out with? And here I am, like, we're rattling off different groups, and we have never interacted. And I'm like, how have we been in different parts of Seattle? Well, it makes total sense. Because, you know, she was really with the black side, and I was mostly hanging out with white side and some black people. So, like, our groups, though, queer and some people, POC and all these things, we're not truly ever going to interact because our bubbles are different. When I hang out in black bubbles, like just black people, different vibe. When I hang out with just like my anime friends, different vibe. When I hang out with my Middle Eastern family, different vibe. Different people, different bubbles, different vibes, different expectations, all living in similar political worlds, but different versions of it, right? So think about like what had to happen in my life for me to have that. And I don't believe in destiny or anything like that. I believe like your life is a reflection of your choices, give or take the details of where you're born and how things happen. But I don't think life happens to you. I think life happens around you. And when I say make peace in the chaos, I need you to channel in your Korra, go to Korra, Avatar Korra. You have to take Korra when she's learning airbending and she's going through those doors that are spiraling the chaos around her and she has to learn how to dance within that chaos, that's what I want for you. But that path, going and knowing all the parts of you, you know how on Avatar they have to know the 4 elements to kind of be whole people? Same thing with your life, right? But there's 2 variations in the world of the 2's and the world of the 5's. You can find those 4 elements in the world of the 2's that will give you a most happy life. And you can go on to a different journey to define the 4 elements into enlightenment, which is very different than the 2's, but sometimes gets mistaken for the same thing. So what we do is we see these people in mass media, these like influential gurus and yoga people and these people claiming to have enlightenment, but they're branding it and boxing it in capitalism and selling you a product. What I'm saying to you is that there's nothing you have to buy. Everything for enlightenment is free. Free. It's in books, it's in media, it's in culture, it's in people. Go talk to your neighbors, go talk to people. You have to do this as a 2 who's happy and as a 5 into enlightenment. Okay, scoot the 5 conversation out. Let's focus more on the 2's. So I want to give you examples of two bubbles that I'm going to be able to observe using the philosophy system and be able to notice that I don't live in this reality, okay? Here's my notes. Starting off with 1, do you remember the Gorilla Glue girl? The woman who put Gorilla Glue in her hair and then had to go to the hospital. It was like a big viral moment on the internet. Well, the thing that's interesting is not her so much. That's just like she did a human thing. It's life. The people in the comment sections of those videos, Sioux culture versus non-Sioux culture. So in the world of the 2's, there was 2 distinct camps. One that was like, this girl better sue that company. They're rich. The bottle was deceiving. Deception. Disgrace. Every time you say deception, you have to sing disgrace. It's very important. Okay, so she has this moment where she has to pick and choose. The world is on her. The world is telling her, pick, sue, don't sue, sue, don't sue. The sue people think that it's, you know, she can get money, it's necessary, it is what it is. The other people think she would be lazy, rude, unethical, dishonest if she sued. I'm just like looking at these 2 camps of people and I'm just thinking like, how about more answers than these answers, right? She could be a person that sues because she genuinely didn't realize it was Gorilla Glue, which would possibly make it... So in order for that to have happened, she would have been illiterate, which is possible, and we don't want to judge people. But if you're telling me this grown woman couldn't read a bottle, then maybe you have a case. So in order for her to be able to sue ethically, she would have to be at a position where she would have to admit she couldn't read a bottle. Okay? In order for her to be a person who doesn't sue, she would have to be a person who can read a bottle. So she cannot sue them ethically if she can read a bottle. Right? So she would be dishonest. But like something has to exist for these two things to even be discussed. Like there would have to be more knowledge of the woman to really come to a conclusion. But it's funny because I don't have that answer. I don't know what she should do. But these two groups were pretty damn sure they know. And so that's what's interesting. Abba and Preach, one of my favorite YouTube channels, because they're my favorite two number twos who are obviously on a journey and trying to be introspective and who have been on a journey. I actually talked about this in my live show on Patreon yesterday. We do agree, I think overall my audience and I, that Abba is having a harder time making peace with existence, even as a two, because he, I think, has been hurt enough and has hurt people enough to know that he doesn't have it yet. But Preach has a peace about him, an understanding. When he covers kink or poly or weird people, he's very comfortable with it. But that doesn't mean he's on a road to enlightenment, though I think he's more likely to reach it than Abba, because Abba has stagnation in his energy rather than Preach, who's open. So Preach has an I'm open, but I have boundaries. Abba has a I want to be open, but I have too much baggage energy to him. And what's funny is that as they cover men and women and how they socialize, they show more than they mean to show in many ways as well, because Abba chooses to go on Fresh and Fit pretty often. Well, I think Preach basically doesn't, give or take, not as much. I think Preach is less interested in these black and white answers to existence than Abba is. So Abba went on this show called Fresh and Fit, which I wanted to make a whole YouTube video about, but I think this is a better place for it. And Fresh and Fit is a part of the internet that exists to counter the feminist movement. They're the red-pilled part of the internet, but there's a spectrum to these two movements. There's like a structure to feminism that allows like different kinds of people who are in it for different kinds of reasons. Same with the red pill community, but again, they are just they're one coin, but other sides of it. Just like Republican and conservative, or Republican and leftists, conservative and leftists, you know what I'm saying? They are different sides of a coin. So I'm watching Fresh and Fit with Abba, and I'm thinking to myself, why is Abba on this channel? They are obviously not as introspective as him. And Abba still isn't as introspective as Preach. Like, they have levels, right? But in the world of the twos, Abba has had enough connection with shitty women, shitty people, hypocrites, and he falls more in the red pill side of YouTube. He's talked about how it's helped him feel validated as a man, and I think that's important. Just like when I was feeling invalidated by the people in my life, I embraced feminism that helped to validate myself as a woman, helped me relate to a lot of people. But eventually it became my stagnation because I'm not an agreeable woman. And so I noticed that I'm in great conflict with agreeable women. And that's a problem because my ways of finding solutions for the world don't always fit in their narratives of what is allowed and not allowed. For Abba, though, enough of the narratives of Fresh and Fit fit into his narrative to allow him to sit on a show where the hosts, all people of color, literally most of the people there are people of color, he can sit on a show that allows black men in specific to represent themselves as Flanders, shallow, hitting on gold diggers, and as the saviors of these poor women who are too slutty to know better. And that's incredibly number two of all of them.
DVO, Maxo, short-term bang, the attractive guy, and long-term marry the rich guy. But what do you bring to the table?
That's a very good one. Very good one.
We want to go around the table with that one?
So, mm-hmm. Okay, I'll add a caveat to that as well, sure, right? So, for example, what do you bring to the table outside of sex?
Ooh. Say again?
Okay, what do you bring to the table?
You spoke Chinese.
Foreign question. Okay.
Miss Mexico.
Yes.
What do you bring to the table to a man, right, that you're taking serious?
Yeah.
outside of sex.
What do you think she will bring?
I'm going on the panel.
Have you ever been in a relationship that you obviously have sex, but what does she bring to the table besides that? Tell me.
Well, I'm asking you the question.
How it works.
I have an answer, but I would like to know yours.
Okay, well, let's go on the panel first, and then we'll get past your question.
My answer is I don't know. I don't know what I would bring to the table. If this is me, you like it, you don't, you know, let's find out. Let's figure it out together.
Okay. You're keeping it real. I like that. You're being honest.
Wait, you said you have a boyfriend, though, right?
Yeah, I do.
Well, what do you do for him then?
Oh, a lot of things. Do you want to know?
Well, I mean, we literally just asked you that.
Do you want to ask him?
Yeah. I'm asking you. I mean, you said I'm not sure what I bring to the table. And then I'm like, wait, aren't you in a relationship?
Honestly, when I'm in a relationship, I'm not like, what am I bringing to the table? Is he happy if I do this? I don't question myself all the time. I'm like, this is who I am. Maybe today.
But do you notice something interesting? Yes. When you were asked what you're looking for long term, you had a laundry list of stuff you mentioned. But then when you're asked, what
I just said fun, good sex, and somebody who would like change with me, and we both like grow together.
Okay, so let's say you brought four things, but then when you were asked, what do you bring to that person? Then you're like, I don't know. Do you understand how there's like a confusion there?
It's not confusing for me. I don't know if there's somebody else that's not as confused as you.
All right, I'm the confused one. I'll take that.
All right. So I think I bring a lot to the table. I'm super motivated. Like, you just want to be my man. You need the support system. And I'm all about my man. I support him. I encourage him. I motivate him. I push him. I'm there for him. I love him. I'm all about him as long as he's all about me.
Okay. So you cater to your man then?
Yeah.
All right.
And I think Fresh and Fit are 2 C's. Like, they're not really functional in their own lives. And I started to feel bad for the women. And then the women spoke. And I was like, I do not feel bad for these women. Like, not in the way that people want me to. Because the women who go on Fresh and Fit are gold diggers. They have big boobs and slutty clothes, and not for sakes of fashion. They're not just fashionably sexy. That's different. Like, that's a category of, like, you know, erotic art and like feminist expression, or drag is very sexual, queer is very sexual, but it's not the same way these girls are. These girls are like literally trying to capture the attention of a rich man. They specifically are the kinds of women who hang out with like sports guys and parties. Like, the men in this Fresh and Fit podcast were literally saying women have female privilege because they get invited to drag parties and men don't. And I'm like sitting in there like, I'm gonna be real with you. I would never go to a drag party. If Drake for sure call me up, try Drake, just try to call me up right now. He's like, I don't know how Drake talks. He's got that weird voice. He's just like, Brittany, you got to go to the left and slide into my party. I'd be like, Drake, you're all my sons, as the great Nicki Minaj would say, and I ain't coming. Like, I ain't going to fuck with you. Not because I don't respect Drake. I just don't give a fuck about Drake. Like, he's not in my bubble of usefulness. Like, he's just a rapper who doesn't rap about anything I relate to, doesn't make music I like, and doesn't have a life I relate to. You know what I mean? Like, what about him would appeal to me? But the idea that this woman who's at this table, these women would be like, oh, a Drake party? Oh my God, a Drake party? Oh my God, a Drake party? Like, they would be like, oh, I'm gonna find a husband. And I'm sitting here like, bro, I'm trying to find a husband on a ranch who's tractor rich, not like rapper rich, you know? Like, these women are sitting here saying they're men. They're like, I would date an average man. I just need him to make at least like $100,000 a month. And I'm like, $100,000 a month? Girl, you lucky if we make $100,000 a year.
JC cheated on Beyonce. You're aware of it, right?
Yeah, I'm aware.
She took him back.
Yeah.
Why?
Oh, okay. Hold on. Okay, I like this.
She has a kid with him.
You want to handle this? You know what? Listen, there's some women who understand that there's things that matter more in life than whether or not your man is loyal. Some people believe in legacy. Mm-hmm. Some people build an empire. She knows that if she probably left the man, everything that they've been striving for together would probably just not work out, and they'd have to do things apart. Right. So sometimes you sacrifice. That's not necessarily an indication of unconditional love.
Yeah,
it just means like, you know what? I'm going to tolerate this because I believe that the thing that we're working for is more important. And I would also say this. I'm not mad at you. You have your ideas. You have your perception of love or whatever it is.
No, there's no reason to be mad.
But I would also say, as you get older in life, you start to realize that there are conditions and there are asterisks. Whether it's marriage, mm-hmm. whether it's love, it's like, if you don't hold up your end to the bargain and it goes on long enough, mm-hmm. I got to go deuces. And you can say, oh, I still love you and I'm doing this so it can help you change because you need to realize rock bottom. But from the man's perspective, it's like, you're bailing because I'm not doing what you need me to do and you don't love me unconditionally. it was based off of whether or not I met those needs.
Yep. I think that's just one perspective.
Sure.
Definitely there's many perspectives to that. If you talk about marriage, then you have vows. And if you break those vows, then it's kind of like breaking love. But when you have those vows and you say till love do us part, sickness and death and whatever, what you're saying is you're staying with that person even though you know there will be disagreements and mistakes. And the thing is, you are promising to work it out. When you cannot work it out, that's when you get a divorce, right? You're breaking your vows. You're basically falling on your own ways because you are deciding to do so. It does not mean that you one day from another decide, I'm not going to love that person anymore. We are all humans, you know? People still love even though they understand that they have to leave each other for the greater good, because you don't want to raise a kid with two parents that are constantly fighting or that simply cannot get along anymore because of the different perspectives and views.
That sounds great, but women initiate over 80% of the divorces. But, you know, it is what it is, right?
What is this? Like, who are these people? They are, like, the least functional. And I'll tell you this, because in the world of the 2Cs, they're just people who, like, don't even understand. They're at the worst part of their own existence because the money doesn't matter. See, the world of the 2's, 2Bs, my mother, my father, most of people in the world, I believe, the 2Bs are people who understand that life is about family and love, and it's about being responsible enough to make enough money to feed your kids. But it's not about having yachts or flashy cars. When they have the stereotype of the man who gets a divorce and then dates a younger girl and buys a fancy car, those are not functional people in terms of like enlightenment or joy or peace. Those are people in crisis, right? That's a crisis move. And so what I'm trying to say is, don't think it ain't a crisis move if, you know, if you think money and nice cars are a point of success. Like, I'm looking at them like sad. Sad to spend that much money on a car. Sad. Like, it's just sad. It's very superficial. I don't like it. And that's different, too, if they get it for free or maybe they're sponsored or, like, there's a lot of ways to get it that's not shallow. But in this particular instance, it pretty much is. And the worst part is, like, one of the hosts of the show, he's all like, men have a biological need to spread their seed. And so women should expect, you know, a consensual open relationship automatically. And I'm like, that is a ridiculous statement. People are monogamous. Absolutely. My father would look at these men like they were children. And the worst part is they reference Jordan Peterson to make their point more valid. And the funny part is that Jordan Peterson creates content to help men like this grow up. Like, literally, his content is created for these men. So when feminists hear Jordan Peterson speak, and I was there too before I got therapy and got better and could hear him, I thought he was also like these men. And then what I realized is like, no. He's trying to tell these men how to be real men. But because he's also countering feminist theory, and the other side of these men are Tumblr feminists, I'm like losing my energy trying to explain the world of the 2's. Because this part of the 2's is so chaotic to me because they're the least functioning people. So I just like, let's push them to the side. In the world of the 2's my parents live in, like people who mean well, I find someone you're genuinely interested in, and make love and have babies and live a good life. It's not so complicated as saying like, oh, I need a yacht and I need big boobs and I need plastic surgery. Like, I don't know who's raising you. And I'm sorry if you've gone down this path and you're truly not happy every day. Stop. It's not for you. If you need plastic surgery and then you feel great after, that's good. It was good for you. If you get plastic surgery and you constantly feel like you need more and more and more and more and more to the point where you're wiping out your face, stop. You're not in the right place. If you're dating men who treat you like shit and you're looking at your life, stop picking those men. There are other men to date. If you're dating women who are constantly gold digging, stop dating gold diggers. If you think all women are gold diggers, you're not meeting enough people. That's what I'm trying to say. In the world of the 2's, this is what happens. But you'll notice in the world of the 2's, everyone always says 80% of men, 90% of men, 90% of women, 80% of women. In Fresh and Fit, they go 90% of women. Most women are gold diggers, or most women want rich men who make $100,000 a month. And I'm like, who are these women? Do you get what I'm trying to say? They're living in a bubble that's consistent because they're consistently meeting these people. So they don't have to doubt themselves. They can say with very strong conviction, all women, most women, most women, most women are this way. Wow, most women won't admit this. Wow, most women, they can do that. Sometimes, though, you can generalize in a way that actually does work, i.e. most men, okay, most men have penises. Most women have vaginas. Some humans are born anomalies with different genitalia or different or gender dysphoria. All people are born, you know, with complicated or simple existences, but how you pursue those existences is going to be dependent on your bubble and how you process that bubble. So if you're born trans, you might only process your existence in the way that cis people see you, which is not good. Okay, it's not good. You want to process your existence in how you see yourself, and then how the world operates with that existence, and then how you can operate within it. If you live a life as a trans person only wanting the validation of cis people because you need it to feel valid in your gender, that's a struggle, dude, and I don't recommend going down that path. And as a 2, I don't think you need to reach enlightenment to make peace with the fact that people don't like you, okay? So I think that people who are queer, trans, and other are a little bit, can have a little bit of a leg up on people in terms of their own understanding their own existence because they're other, but don't mistake trauma or otherness for enlightenment. So in the world of the 2s, someone might think, I'm trans, I'm queer, I'm woke, I know more about the world than the people around me. But if that's the case, then your life should reflect it. One of the issues I have with racism in America is it's such a number 2 problem. I've said this before, and a lot of people didn't quite like it because they felt like it disregarded or disqualified their complaints. And I don't mean it to sound like this. Listen to me. I'm a Middle Eastern woman. I'm not white. I'm not black. And what I've noticed about America is that it's very arrogant and it assumes everyone is like them. And we are the Logan Paul, or Jake Paul rather, of the world. And I've embraced that chaos because I think that's what happens with freedom. And I think it's healthy and wonderful. If you like diversity, you should like struggle and you should like chaos. But racism in particular has been painted in a very interesting way in the States. It's painted as a black and white issue quite literally. Though other cultures allow Asians to be represented, Middle Eastern people to be represented, it's only in the script of 2 ways. Middle Eastern people are either being discriminated against from white people because they look like terrorists, or Middle Eastern people are not people of color enough to even have an issue explored, because a lot of people look at me and call me a white woman, which is only accurate if we're describing the color of my skin. But if you're using white to mean European descent or somebody who didn't grow up with parents from Iraq, then it gets a little confusing to me. In Iraq, we're considered Caucasian or whites, you know, like, because in Iraq, a lot of people who were the dominant culture were people of color, browner than us. So we were all the same people, basically, but there was a hierarchy on skin color that was really interesting. A lot of that stemming from religious association, because we were the Catholics in the Middle East, while the Muslims were mostly the majority. So again, you have to understand, like, I'm looking at the world trying to process it through these lenses, and I'm trying to really decipher what this all means. You know, a while back, I made a video about how cultural appropriation is petty. I also think racism is, it's weird. It's like petty, but also really reasonable sometimes. God, they're going to take me out of context with this clip and put it on TikTok. Just watch. But it makes sense from like a otherness way. Like, oh, that person is other. I'm afraid of them. I don't know what to do with them. In the same way that Black Americans talk about how they're afraid of white people. The same white, like, the people there, it's weird. It's like they're afraid of white people because they associate white people with their oppressor. White people are afraid of black people because they associate it with someone totally different and not relatable to them. And these are just like the subcategories of 2s that actually like have these thoughts. And then there's like the rest of us, like the other white people who don't believe that, the other black people that don't believe that. But like, we're all sitting here watching them, and because they're the loudest, they get to run this narrative that is objective, but it's not. And so it's sort of petty in a lot of ways because it's rooted in trauma. And trauma itself is sort of an internal conflict, which when projected onto society causes the chaos of the world of the 2s that they live in, and at the same time brings comfort. Because if black people always expect to be afraid of white people, that's a consistency they can find comfort in. And then if white people can always consistently say black people are bad and they're the enemy, that's also a comfort. It's like a consistency, once again, that allows them to live and continue living an existence that is shallow and rooted in their own narrative. Because remember, when I talk to these extremes, like these people that are like all white people are racist, and then these people who are like all people of color are secondary to white people, I mean, they're not happy people. They're not joyful. They don't see the world for what it is. They see the world for what they know it is. It's very different, right? So far, I think if I was you, I'd start to think that being a 2 is not so great. But I really need to be real with you about the complicated nature of being a 2 and why it's also necessary to have the people that I've described. Here's the hard part. The 2s that I've described, the people that are living through trauma or the people who are projecting or the people who steal or the people who think infidelity is just the natural part of relationships, they are the people who help the rest of us counter our own ideas of the world. They're the road. They're like the weird, windy road we take on our journey in life that we often should grow up to say, ah, that used to be me. But some people get stuck. So that's just how their life's going to go, and we have to accept it. Even as a 2, you must accept that some people will just never be happy. Okay, we'll move those people aside. Well, what happens, though, when you have people who get along with their neighbors, who shake that feeling of I feel targeted off of themselves? Not to reference it again, but on Queer Eye, they went to go hang out with this beautiful Hispanic woman, this Mexican lady that was just so all about her heritage, but a third culture kid, give or take. You know, not Mexican enough, not white enough. Been there. I know it. I know how it feels. I get it. And she's sitting here and she wants to embrace, wants to grow up, wants to be better, wants to, you know, be somebody of substance. And she doesn't have the tools to do it. No one in her life can help her exactly. But here are these 5 fabulous gay guys once again coming into this woman's life and creating an environment where she can not only grow up and be the 42-year-old woman she really wants to be instead of the 42-year-old woman who's still dressing like a teenager at work, because work is different than at home. You can be as childish as you want at work, or at home, I mean. But at work, you really got to be someone that represents to a larger community, I am important, I am a leader. And one of the fears this woman had was she had run into a lot of racism in America, a lot of white people who just didn't like her, which is a real experience people have. Racism is definitely real. It's just not always conveyed in the most real way when we talk about it. And so she had these moments of racist interactions with people and then felt afraid of her neighbors. Like, she was always the Mexican family or the loud family, or they have these like low riders in the driveway and people are going to think they're ghetto, and all these like internal conflicts that she's experiencing. And then finally, she went with, I don't know their names yet, so I referenced them, the black guy. She went with a black guy to like go to the neighbors' houses and talk with the neighbors and express some of that. And I thought it was beautiful. Like, I thought it was beautiful that she went and got a reminder that not everyone is like the one or two neighbors who were rude to her, that she is not secondary to white people, that she is not automatically ghetto because they have low riders in the driveway, that these are a cultural signifier that sends to the minds of people who are not well cultured that this is an automatic association with someone that's low class, but it's just a low rider, you know? So it's like you have to have these balances, but unless you chill with people who are different, unless you've been in those communities, you're not going to see them as people, because you cannot even imagine, because they're so different from you, that they could even be human-like. Why do you think racism stems from this place of objectifying, villainizing, and in creating associations with monsters and animals about the other that we feel so fearful of? We are always going to have moments of conflict and fear when we see things we don't understand, which is why I tell you, you have to force yourself, if you want to, into meeting more people and taking away that bias and that fear. You know what I'm saying? So if we believe we live in America that's a racist country, then everyone is a victim to that racist system, including white people. So you can't be mean to white people. If you believe that America is not racist and it's great, then when you get targeted because of the color of your skin, you justify that as they must have just been mad that day and I was their target. Maybe, doesn't matter. At the end of the day, still humans being humans. But the why matters when we're coming to a conclusion about ourselves and about our existence. So when you read stories about Black people being killed, you want to say, I'm a Black person, I'm going to be killed. But statistically, you can run your life in a way through the chaos in which you can lower down these opportunities sometimes. And then other times, you're born into a circumstance where your trajectory is so painted for you, it feels like you're never going to get out. I just love this episode because she's like crying and realizing like, oh my gosh, I was living in fear. And so that's the hardest part about being a two and finding joy in it, is like you have to break the little bubbles in your two world to realize like it's not as bad as you think. Or maybe sometimes it is, but you can make your life better. And it's really beautiful. And she was crying and she felt so great. And her neighbors came to her event and it was really beautiful. And it's not going to solve racism. It's not going to make world peace happen. It's just going to bring peace in that bubble. Like with my parents and their queer kids, like one of the things that brought peace to our family was realizing that we were mostly talk. That my parents would say things like, I can't be around my kids if they're openly gay. But the truth is that after everything got better, like they are still anti-gay marriage, but we still all show up to the house. Like my sister's living with them right now. Marcus and I visit. Like we all hang out. We are who we are. And it's going to be harder once we find partners. And it's going to be weird if I marry a woman versus a man. And all these things will change how, you know, the future will go. But for right now, at least when we get there, we'll know we'll all be in a good place to handle it. Much better than before. Before, when we thought in our world of the twos that, like, they were going to hate me forever because they're anti-gay marriage, or that my parents thought I'm going to be a pedophile because I'm gay. Like, you don't think this worried them, that I was going to go to hell or that I would be a bad person? Of course it did. So until I really understood where they were coming from and was able to be the bigger person because I knew more, I could talk to them better. You know what I'm saying? So even in the world of the twos, you can find peace and harmony with people who are different, but you have to embrace what bubble you're in. And that's what's so beautiful about life, is like realizing that it doesn't have to be a trauma or a tragedy. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't have to have a tragedy in your life every day to have a life that's lived. A life that's lived has trauma in it at one point, or tragedy at one point, because that's life. You don't have to orchestrate more of it. You can, and you can choose. In the world of the twos, the greatest, most beautiful thing about it is the comfort of the consistency, the lack of doubt. As an example, and I'm going to preface this very hard with, this is a distinct difference, and I need you just to hear me through it. My five friend who's gay, him and I discuss whether or not homosexuality is a negative anomaly in the evolutionary process of our species. And we can openly have that conversation because ultimately, like, we're still queer, we're going to be queer. But we still have the opportunity to ask ourselves in a more nuanced and clear way what this means. We also can't have these conversations necessarily with twos, because twos have been begging me to, like, cover whether or not homosexuality is, like, an issue or an anomaly or a genetic defect or any of these things. But they want me to figure it out. So if it is true that it is, that we stop gay people from being gay. But in the world of the five, I don't need to stop people from doing anything just because it's harmful. In the world of the twos, the comforting part of it is that it's a clear good guy and bad guy. And I love that. In the world of the fives, everyone's on a journey. So you're meeting people at blips of time in their existence. This doesn't always define them forever. But it could, because they could make such permanent decisions that it has to now, to some extent. But those are very rare cases, and they're almost hard to articulate. So when you are open, when you're honest with yourself, you can ask yourself the questions as a five that come off differently in the world of the twos. In the world of the twos, if somebody said, do you think BLM is good for the world? Well, you could say maybe not the organization, but maybe the movement. Or maybe not the movement because they blow up police cars. But maybe there's another way. In some ways, we need the chaos to move society forward. So in some ways, we need the people who are extreme to make us grateful for our lives, to remind ourselves, okay, we're not that crazy. To remind ourselves, ooh, sometimes you got to be that crazy to move things forward. But we need everyone to do what they're going to do in life to make life happen. So as much as you want to be mad at, like, Elon Musk, how mad can you really be? As much as you want to be mad at BLM protests, like, how mad can you be? They think this is the only path forward, and this is the decision they're making off what they know. How can you be mad at Tea Partiers or even conservatives? Like, how can you be mad at anyone, really, if everyone's living in a bubble? Well, you can be mad at them because the consistency of your bubble, the comfort of your bubble, tells you this is your enemy. So it allows you for your life to feel very vindicated, which is nice. Why not? Why not go down that path, right? There's no reason for you to stop because you all need to exist anyways for everything to move forward. But that sounds confusing and kind of condescending. And then that makes people go, well, wait a second. I don't want to be the crazy person. Well, then don't be. Then don't be. That is also an option. In the world of the twos, you can be a chill number two. You can be chilling in your life, living your best life. And the only one who's your enemy are the people who come for you and your family. That's a version of being a number two. You can have consistency and reliability and love by being a number two who lives in the middle of nowhere and you know your neighbors and you live in a small town and you can rely on your neighbors to be consistent and safe and loving. You can do that. All of these are options. You can live in New York in the hate, like in the chaos of art and politics. You can live on Twitter where they literally will hate you if you voted for Trump, period, the end, or hate you if you're pro-BLM, period, the end. These are all places we can live in and find a really good, solid, consistent existence in. If you want consistency, the world can offer it to you. There are bubbles you can live in. If you want to explore a deeper sense of existence, it's a lonely journey because you have to leave the world of the twos. You have to leave everything you've built behind. And then you have to come back to it in a way that serves your joy. You know, one of the reasons I don't cover specific stories on my channel is because I don't want to curate an audience that wants drama or negative energy. And I don't want to give voices or clout to people that I think are truly never going to get better. So there are certain YouTubers, I will never talk about them. I will never review their videos. And I know a lot of people didn't want me to review Trisha Paytas's, but I'll tell you this. This will probably be one of the few last times I have to, because she's basically making it clear who she is. So if I deem in the next 6 months she's a one, that's it. No more content about Trisha Paytas. And that's the thing. If we can't learn from her, why are we talking about her? But that's very hard to do. And especially if you know that negativity breeds views, then you know as a YouTuber in the world of that existence, you are best served by always talking about horrible people. Therefore, sending the messages to everyone's brains in your audience that the world is dealing with people like this often. Well, in my worldview, you're only dealing with these people often because you keep talking and engaging with them. And that includes narcissists on YouTube, white nationalists. Like, one of the things that Black Lady really did for me was allow me an opportunity to consider focusing my energy on the people who would hear me. One of the reasons I love you guys and my audience is because y'all know where I'm coming from because you're listening to me. You know I'm not trying to run a cult. Girl, you know I'm too lazy for that shit. You know the cults of the world are for people who want to be told what to do and how to think, and I'm not with that. But you also know I respect ancient religions, and I think people should be religious because I think it offers consistency, structure, and stability, the three things we need in life to feel fulfilled as humans. And I can't fault people for doing that. There's so much beauty in the world of the twos. It's just chaotic. And once you learn to organize that chaos, whether you're a two or a five, your life will be better. Okay, so let's talk about Harold and Maude for a hot second. I wanted to talk about it more in this podcast, but I'm not going to. I actually think It's actually a perfect video to reference as like fours and fives. But if you watch Harold and Maude, since I did mention it, I want you to recognize that Harold and Maude is a journey about the three, fours, and fives. I do personally think Harold is more of a three when the movie starts, though Kyoti, I think, argues he's a four. Kyoti, correct me if I'm wrong. But either way, he journeys from a 3-4 to a 5 throughout the film because he's got a 5 who can guide him. And this is the struggle I think 2s feel and 5s and 4s and 3s feel, is we need mentors. We need people who can lead us. But how do we know who to trust when humans are so complicated and then we find out our leaders are secret awful humans behind closed doors? Well, it's the balance of the pedestal issue. Don't put people on a pedestal, including yourself, but most certainly don't put the human experience on a pedestal. The human experience is complicated and messy, and it is not smooth like this tea. It is full of very jarring things. When Harold and Maude was first made, it was not embraced. It's a very complicated story that holds a lot of nuance, and it can be very jarring for people to see. It's a love relationship between a woman who's basically 80 and a boy who's 20. It's an interesting experience and exploration into this boy's journey. And like Kyoti says, if a five takes a two and treats them like a four, it could cause them to go insane. Because a four is already at a stage where they've let go of all of the world of the twos. And now they're sitting by themselves in the chaos of no bubble. No bubble is very scary. When I was a four, it was the hardest stage in my journey. And I felt so exhausted at the end of it. And I was just like, oh my God, is this it? And I was like, oh Lord, you know, like, mm-mm. And it was funny because when you're a two and a nihilist, you kind of can feel hopeless. And as a four, I never felt hopeless. I just felt disappointed, I think is the word. Like, I didn't know what to do with any of this information. I felt almost like shocked, I think. But I had a five in my life who could guide me forward, just like Harold did. I had a Maude. I didn't have to sleep with my Maude to understand myself. It's a platonic relationship. But it is one of those things where we needed each other to help. So why I share the levels on YouTube is to be that voice for people, is to be a person who can say, I know you're on a journey and I'm not here to dictate your destination. I'm here to just help you think about things differently, because I cannot help but think about things completely differently now. I have no way of identifying with those emotions I used to have in the past. Like when I see, you know, a person blow up a car, I'm like, yeah, well, when people get into a mob, they get crazy. When I see people go and storm the Capitol, I'm like, yeah, when people are in a mob, they do crazy things. It's just like, I don't want to pretend to be shocked anymore about humans being human. But if you're a two, it's going to feel shocking, scary, nerve-wracking. It's going to feel, even as a three, because you're still hopping between the world of the two and the four, it's going to feel intimidating. You don't have to go down this path of figuring it out. You can become successful, beautiful people in your bubbles. We need people who are twos in their bubbles, you know? Camille Paglia, she's like a feminist, right? You could say a feminist. She's a person who has been basically rejected by the establishment, which is ironic since Vice and Vogue are on the back of this book promoting it, saying it's genius. Because at the time when she was coming out and exploring her feminism, she really was a disagreeable woman, but also a trans person in identifying her play with gender, not necessarily how we define trans now. That's not the same. Drag, exploration, queerness, sex, drugs, an exploration into self, liberation, freedom, choice. It's not a matter of what we're doing sometimes. It's the why of why we're doing it. And one of the reasons she gets associated with Jordan Peterson is because people think she's rather conservative now, which is sort of ironic, of course, because it's the same thing I feel when people try to pigeonhole me. It's really important that when we judge people, we try to examine in what way we even have the knowledge to judge them. As conservative people like my parents, they like certain homosexuals that are on a journey of taking celibacy vows. Michael Voris is a Catholic YouTuber who my parents love. He's a gay man who does not engage in gay behavior because he sees it like a normal sin, like sleeping around or having an abortion. It's all a sin at the end of the day, right? And he doesn't do those things. And so he's living a Catholic life. My parents like him. They like me. But they can't approve of everything I do because it would contradict their reality of their two bubble. Just like if I hang out with my trans friends and let's say someone's non-binary, identifying as non-binary as a separate entity, separate from being a boy or a girl, denying even the reality of their sex, then if I sit there with them and we have that conversation, I go, I never deny the reality of sex, but gender is fun to play with, right? They're hearing something very specific from me, often associated with the world of the twos in which they have interacted with conservatives, denying trans people to be able to live as the gender they feel. And what I'm trying to say, and I think what Camille is trying to say, and a lot of people are trying to say, is that you can do and should do whatever you want. But in the process of doing whatever you want, you need to understand if it is the most objective answer, and if it's not, you cannot ask other people to follow you down your journey. One of the dilemmas of the twos running the world is that they create war and starvation and ridiculous inefficiency. Fives, I find, or people who are focused on enlightenment, are less concerned about holding grudges or being involved with people. They're still human and feel great emotion and empathy and love. That's not the same thing of what I'm talking about right now. What I'm talking about is the simplicity of how people function. As an example being, a person should dress a certain way at a certain place. Yeah, if you're trying to set off a certain image. But if a person came to my home, dressed whatever the way they wanted, for the most part, I couldn't think of an outfit someone could wear to my home that I would deny them entry because of it. But if you came to my parents' home, they would deny you entry into their home based off how you're dressed, myself included. If I'm a little sluttier that day, my mom makes me put on a jacket. But if someone came to my home, I wouldn't even think about it. If somebody came to a liberal, and I've seen this happen, like a nudist liberal home, and they're dressed in hijab or a headscarf or however you identify this word, and then conservative clothing, I've had them say things like, ugh, I hate that they're not like getting naked. It's like they're trying to say they're better than us. And I'm like, y'all are such number twos, right? Sometimes I think we force ourselves into thinking we're pro-diversity because we want to pretend that we are. And sometimes we are, even as twos. But to me, diversity means radically accepting people for who they are and knowing how to interact with those people in limitation, like in limited ways. And I think those are very different things. And I hope this makes sense because I struggle when I read Camille and she talks about gender, my brain goes, I understand this. When people on the internet talk about gender, when I read their books about not being men or women, I'm like, I don't understand what you're talking about, right? Like, I don't understand it. But this I understand. So if they're both using the word trans or gender fluid or they're both exploring gender, the fact that that alone can be explored different ways tells me that this surpasses not only the world of the two, but while in the world of the two, even if you're woke enough to, you know, move past the binary, you still have to follow it with your language and your thinking past that. Or you don't have to, and you can continue to exist in a world that's consistent, that doesn't make you feel doubtful, and that allows you a chance to feel reaffirmed in your identity no matter how crazy it gets. And that is the struggle of the two. And that's the struggle with enlightenment. It's like, how do you pick a path of enlightenment if it's asking you to abandon everything you know? Another example I like to use, because this week I'm having a bad hair week, and I'm just like, headscarf, that's what I do, girl. And this is like one of my favorite headscarf companies. I'll link them in the description because I love them, not sponsored. And one of the things that I sometimes run into is people thinking I'm Muslim. But I'm not Muslim, I'm just wearing a headscarf. One of the other issues I fall into is that people, mostly white women, will ask me, can I wear a headscarf? I am not your keeper. I am not your dictator. I'm not your mother. I'm not your God. Don't ask me if you can wear a headscarf. Ask yourself, should I wear a headscarf today? And girl, if you want to wear a headscarf, get ready to rock the headscarf, girl. Because I think we should make it a fashion statement. Mm-hmm, I do. But I also think you should be aware that if you interact in the world of the twos, different bubbles, some people might associate you with a religion known as Islam. Or depending on how you're wearing it, maybe it's a little bit more Jewish. Because there are a lot of cultures that wear headscarves. Same way I feel about braids. I know Black people love their hair. And I know they want to make a statement that it's theirs and these styles are theirs. And that's fine in the world of the 2's, but it has no place on the road to enlightenment. In what way would an enlightened person think to hoard a hairstyle? Why would an enlightened person hoard clothing? What value do these material expressions offer us in the path of enlightenment? Very little, if nothing. The only way it benefits anyone to have a uniform is so we can feel less afraid of the people we're around. When I talk to Black people, one of their concerns is that if they see a white person who dresses or talks like them, they don't know if they're making fun of them or if they're really a friend. They don't know if they're friend or foe. They don't know if they're faking it and they're not really chill. And I think that all makes sense. You absolutely should be wary and a little concerned that the people you're around might not get you. I remember my sister always tells this story about this guy who called her a terrorist because she's Middle Eastern. And she was like, "Ooh, yeah, I don't know you like that, though." Like, she didn't say that to him at the time, but she was, like, in her head, didn't know what to do because she's working on not being so agreeable. And she didn't know what to do. And I was like, I probably would have just said, "I don't know you like that, though." And then he would have said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean offense," or maybe I meant offense, or maybe, like, we're all the same. And that's the thing, too, is that I don't think it's wrong to question how a person interacts with you. I think it's wrong to come to the wrong conclusion and then write it out like it's the truth. So that's the dilemma I have overall, is that the path of enlightenment can't be for all of us because some of us cannot let go of the roots we've established. I had to cut mine all off and disappear, literally. And so I think it's just a struggle. Again, my job is not to convince you to, like, be enlightened. Like, it doesn't matter. My job is to get you to a place where you're happy in your bubble, or if you're not happy in your bubble, how to explore other bubbles, or if no bubbles in the world work for you, how to continue down the path of enlightenment. So, okay, to close up this podcast, because girl, I am running late. Oh my God, I gotta go. I have a call in 15 minutes. Every day I get less and less mad at the world. Every day I feel more and more happy with the world. And I cannot wait to see over the years how much happier I get with my existence. But I'm telling you right now, happiness is sort of fluid. You can be happy one day and sad the next day. But joy is like a high feeling. It's like fucking the best acid trip of your life. And joy can be experienced by the world of the 2's in very specific situations, like the birth of a child, a wedding day, a soldier coming home, seeing someone you haven't seen in many years come back into your life. It's this really great moment that keeps you going. And I do think that people can exist in a reality where they have that every day. But I don't think it's necessary. I think what's necessary is to be happy and consistent and have structure and have community. And that, my friends, that's open for all of us at any stage in our life. We just got to know how to find it and navigate and be the people we really want to see in the world. I know it's really difficult to live by your values, but you have to find them. You have to decide what truly is a value that I hold that won't stop me from being joyous when I make it. You know, when you meet conservatives who say, "Oh, I dress modestly because I want to, not just because it's part of my religion." And you know, it's true that they genuinely feel sexy or modest. And you're like, "Yeah, rock it, girl. Rock it, boy." And then you meet people who are like, "I'm modest because God tells me to, and I'm not a whore." It's like, okay, girl, you know you ain't at peace with that lifestyle choice, right? Same when I meet women who are like, "I don't need no man, fuck men. Men's tears, I'm gonna drink it all, fuck men." I'm like, "Ooh, you sound really happy, dude. You do not sound happy. I'm being facetious. You do not sound happy. You sound miserable." Like, you can't really believe that, right? Versus some of the women I meet who live in 2 bubbles who are crazy, and they're literally like, "All men are worthless. And that's just how it is." And I'm like, okay, girl, go live on your island. Go be happy on your weird island of 12 people. I think those things exist mostly in cults. Like, whatever, go exist, because they don't know how to be any happier than that. But like, those are not the same people as like regular people, right? Think about what kind of a brain you would need to discount 50% of the population. Like, think about what kind of a brain you would have to think that Black people are secondary to white people. Like, I have a Middle Eastern family member who hates being Middle Eastern. He wants to be white. And he works really hard to appear white. And I'm going to be real, girl. He on a journey of extreme identity struggle, right? And I watch him, and I literally, it's so strange. And he tells me all the time, you try so hard to be Middle Eastern. And I'm like, girl, I'm literally 100% Middle Eastern. There's nothing else about it. Like, that is what it is. But I'm not going to be ignorant enough to say that in the world of the twos, people don't perceive me as white because I, quote unquote, talk white. Talk about fucking stereotypes found in every part of the world of the twos. I've had Black BLMers tell me I talk white and I have no place to talk for POC. And I've had white people tell me, you know, you're not white. You don't know my struggle. I don't want to be a part of your struggle. I'm ditching your struggle. Here's my alarm. I gotta go. I have a call to do. The point of this podcast is not to be your cult leader. I do not want to lead you into some fucking heaven. I'm telling you right now, my job is to give you the tools, which are free at the library, in the form of books, okay, that will help you on your journey, no matter what path you're going down, to find peace and love and consistency in it. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying the answers to the universe are found both in the world of the twos, because you have a point in which you can really stop and be happy for the rest of your life, and that's good. And then it also exists for the people who are struggling, who can't find a place in the world, in the bubble. There's another path, okay? But all paths are found in the knowledge and history shared amongst all humans. All humans contribute to the answers of the world, even the really shitty ones. Because the really shitty ones give us a really good example of maybe not what to do. Again, in the Confucius quote, the little comic, the idea behind it is not to see the bad in others and judge them, but to see the bad in others and make sure that if it's in us, we work on ourselves and live by example. Jordan Peterson said that the best way to help a borderline is to live by example. The best way to help someone who's lost is to live by example. And if you right now are telling me you are living by example and I go to your social media and you say all blank are bad people, then what I'm learning by example is that I'm allowed to say whole groups of people are bad and write them off. I can't live in that world, whether I was a two or a five. And I think that the happiest twos are people who don't live in bubbles where they write groups of people off, no matter how complicated it gets. Guys, I hope this helped. I really do. I am a little unsure at this point because your girl ranted for a while. So please leave your comments in the text sections down below. Check out Spotify. Check out Patreon. And I will see you this upcoming Tuesday for a live show on YouTube, 3 p.m. Pacific. Okay, remember, I go live every Tuesdays, but they switch between Patreon and YouTube so people can get different variations of my spoons and energy. And with that said, I gotta go. Thank you. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.
She gonna say she's Israeli?
Abba and preach. You guys know I like Abba and preach. And of course, I am the child of immigrants. My parents are from Iraq. We are
Iraq. Okay, I'm just glad you didn't say my parents are from Iraq, because then I would have been like, bitch, stop lying. Iraq. But I have proof. I didn't expect that she would be from Iraq. I don't know why I'm yelling that. Overall, really highly recommend. I think she's doing really good for herself. Sometimes you can have really great content and just people haven't seen it yet. So as far as Brittany Simon goes, I think she's doing great stuff. I think she's just going to have to hit her stride eventually when one video blows up and then a bunch of people come in. But, you know, good for her.
My head in real life while in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, da, da, da.